Let's continue our discussion of interference in thin films. We discussed how the concept of destructive interference is used for anti-reflection coatings. Not only destructive interference finds a use in solar cells. Photonic crystals use constructive as well as destructive interference to form an effective back reflector. A dielectric back reflector consists of multiple layers of two different dielectric materials. The first layer has a high refractive index denoted by NH, while the second layer has a low refractive index indicated here by NL. The red lines depict a wave propagating through the dielectric back reflector. At each interface, a fraction of the wave is reflected, while the remaining fraction is transmitted. At the interface between layers 1 and 2, the wave is reflected without a phase shift, since the refractive index of layer 2 is lower than layer 1. This reflection is indicated by the dashed blue line. The reflection at the 2-3 interface, indicated by the solid blue line, does exhibit a phase shift of 1 pi, since the refractive index of layer 3 is higher than that of layer 2. A fraction of the wave reflected at the 2-3 interface will undergo a second reflection at the 2-1 interface. This reflection, indicated by the green dashed line, will again experience a 1 pi phase shift. The reflected and transmitted waves will interfere with each other. The optical thickness, meaning n times d, of each of the layers equals a quarter of the intended wavelength. We have just seen that such an optical thickness on the normal incidence causes a phase shift of 1 pi. So, how then do the reflected waves interfere? Let's consider the 1-2 interface. The two waves exhibit a phase shift due to the reflection at the 2-3 interface and due to the optical path length difference between the two waves. The total phase shift difference between the waves is therefore equal to 2 pi. The wave reflected at the 3-4 interface will also interfere at the 1-2 interface. As this wave was reflected when propagating towards a low refractive index, it will not experience a 1 pi phase shift. The optical path length difference, however, is twice as long, which means that it still has a 2 pi phase shift with respect to the wave reflected at the 1-2 interface. We can see that regardless of the number of dielectric layers, the reflected wave at each interface will exhibit constructive interference. Let's now consider the transmission at the interfaces. At the 2-3 interface, for instance, the red wave interferes with the twice reflected green wave. The green wave undergoes two reflections with a phase shift, so the total phase shift between the two waves equals 2 pi plus the 1 pi phase shift caused by the optical path length difference. This amounts to a 3 pi phase shift. Also, the reflections of the front surface of the wave R12, denoted by the pink line, and of wave R23, denoted by the yellow line, exhibit a phase shift of an uneven number of pi's with respect to the transmitted wave at the 2-3 interface. As such, the transmitted wave and the waves that undergo an even number of reflections will exhibit destructive interference. This means that at each interface between the dielectric layers, reflection is maximized due to constructive interference and the transmission is minimized due to destructive interference. The field strength of a wave such as this red one will therefore be quickly reduced when propagating through a dielectric back reflector. So, what does the performance of a dielectric back reflector depend on? This graph shows the spectral reflectivity of a dielectric back reflector encompassed by air and amorphous silicon. We can see that the reflectivity is maximal at a certain wavelength, lambda b, which is known as the Bragg wavelength. The Bragg wavelength is equal to 4 times the optical thickness of the dielectric layer. The maximal achievable reflectivity at the Bragg wavelength depends on the refractive indices of the dielectric layers and surrounding media and on the number of pairs, denoted by capital M. A single pair, denoted by P, contains two dielectric layers. The greater the number of pairs, or refractive index mismatch, the higher the reflectivity. The influence of the number of pairs is shown in the graph, where we can see that the dielectric back reflector is a near ideal reflector for a relatively large spectral range. The spectral range, denoted by a delta lambda, is a function of the refractive indices of the dielectric materials as shown in this equation. The larger the refractive index mismatch between the dielectric materials, the larger the effective spectral range of the dielectric back reflector will be. A dielectric back reflector can replace a conventional metallic back reflector. The shown figures illustrates solar cells with these two different types of back reflectors. The advantage of a dielectric back reflector lies in its use of a cheap silicon alloys instead of expensive metals. It also has the advantage that its properties can be tuned to effectively reflect a certain spectral range. A third use of interference in solar cells are diffraction gratings. The illustration shows a uniformly propagating light wave reaching a wall under normal incidence. Since the wall has wavelength-sized slits, the incident light is diffracted into a number of angles. The light is scattered into those angles where constructive interference occurs. This figure shows or uniform incident light wave with wavelengths lambda and the light waves diffracted into a certain angle theta. The width between the two slits is denoted by D. The optical path length difference between wave E1 and E2 equals the distance between points B and C. This equals D times the sine of theta. The total electric field strength of a wave at a certain angle theta is given by the sum of all superimposed waves at that point. The electric field strength of the superimposed wave can be described by the wave equation. The propagation in the z direction has been adjusted to include the optical path length difference between the superimposed waves. Constructive interference occurs for a phase shift of 0 or a multiple of 2 pi. Therefore, if for a certain angle the wave number times the adjusted propagation distance equals a multiple of 2 pi, constructive interference will occur. Hence, light will be diffracted into the direction normal to the grating. Light will also be diffracted into those angles where theta equals the inverse sine of m times lambda over d. Here, m is a value counting the peaks of maximal amplification starting from the normal. This is illustrated in the figure where the direction normal to the diffraction grating is indicated by m is 0. By scattering light away from the normal into large angles, diffraction gratings can be applied to increase the path length of light through the solar cell. To that end, diffraction gratings can be integrated into the front of the solar cell as shown in this illustration. Light incident normal to the surface will be transmitted under large angles into the absorber layer. Alternatively, diffraction gratings can be integrated into the back of the solar cell. In that case, the diffraction grating is used at the front of the back reflector. The light will then be reflected into large angles back into the solar cell. Time for a recap. We discussed interference in thin films and derived equations for which constructive and destructive interference occurs. We saw how this equation can be used to create an anti-reflection layer through destructive interference, and how constructive interference can be used to create a dielectric back reflector. Finally, we discussed how diffraction gratings can be designed to diffract the light into wide angles. This effectively increases the path length of light through the cell. In the next section, we will discuss the scattering of light in solar cells.